Again, we meet online. A friend and I were talking about the fact that in our isolation, we can be near in our prayer concerns and in our care for each other. We also can be together before the very throne of God. Welcome to our Vespers today. As Andy has gathered beautiful music for us, plan to enjoy the familiar Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, with the willingness to admit that I am prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love, while also being aware that He to rescue me from danger completes this truth. How great thou art is sung out on a mountaintop, perfectly, beautifully, with graphics of creation. The Petitions of the Lord's Prayer by Charlotte Church will bend our knees and hearts. Today I read a quote which said, "If this beautiful music is not played and sung at my funeral, then I'm not coming." I liked that. One lyric from one song is, "He flowers each promise of His word." This simply means that God fulfills each promise. He keeps His word. You may have heard the story of the family that gathered around their breakfast table with a little container of cards, and on each of these cards were written a promise of God. And their question was, which one for today? As they reached for one day, the container spilled and they all fell out. Yes, the answer was there. All of the promises of God were in place for that family on that day, and they're in place for us today. We may read them, know them, accept them, and we may thank God as we benefit daily. Mary and Richard continue to share scripture and its application for us. Through devotional thoughts of the attributes of God and three small vignettes of missionary experiences, we will again be encouraged. Thank you for the feedback that you're providing. It keeps us quite motivated as we sometimes face technology challenges. It also encourages us as we pray and plan for the following Sunday. And we would ask you to continue joining us in prayer and care for each other, for the health and well-being of the communities of which we are a part. And of course, as always, prayer for our country. Enjoy Vespers today.
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of Thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by Thy great help I've come, and I hope by Thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed His precious blood. That day when freed from sinning, I shall see Thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing Thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer Take my ransom soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
And now let's pray from the depths of Scripture and from paraphrased words of the Valley of Vision. Our God and Heavenly Father, we come before you acknowledging that you are indeed a great God. We pray that our lofty thoughts and our pride might be scattered to the wind, that we might be prepared for your presence through the grace of your healing touch for our minds and our bodies and our souls. When you are with us, evil cannot remain. We can know peace and rest. Our hearts can even blossom as a beautiful flower with fragrance. Nothing exceeds your power or is too great for you to do. Nothing is too great for you to give. Your might is infinite and your love is boundless. Your grace is limitless and your name is glorious. Father, we are told that even the angels sing for sinners repenting, and prodigals being restored, for captives released, blind eyes opened, and broken hearts bound. The angels rejoice as the despondent are cheered, the self-righteous are stripped, the ignorant enlightened, and as saints are built up by their holy faith. We bow before thee, our great God, learning of you, learning of your word, and learning of your promises to us. We ask of always of you, by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Amen.
I wander and hear the mountain grandeur and see the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well,
it is well with my soul.
When Christ shall come
with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my
joy
heart,
shall fill my heart.
Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
How great thou art, how great thou art.
How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Those of you who've been following our devotional on the Vespers program know that we've been looking at some of the attributes of God, an attribute being, what is God like? And of course, he's omnipotent. Some of these terms I'm sure you'll recognize. Omnipotence means that he's all-powerful. He does what he wants. Omnipresent, he's everywhere, highest heaven, lowest hell. And by the way, just a reminder, Satan is not in hell. Jesus is Lord of hell and not Satan. Satan is on the earth, and he and his minions roam the earth trying to undo the work of God. And then God is omniscient as well. That is, he knows everything. Omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient. There's nothing that he doesn't know, and nothing gets by him. And he knows the darkest, deepest secrets of every person alive, as well as all the good things and everything in between. Now, today I want to continue on something I mentioned last week, and that is the goodness of God. And I thought, well, I'd read from Psalm 145. The Psalms are full of things about God's goodness. And beginning with verse 8, the author says, the Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. And all your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints shall bless you. The saints being us, of course. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power, to make known to the sons of men his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. See, that's our job. Speaking of, we're to talk about the glory of God and his kingdom and of his power, and to make known his deeds to people. And he says, your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord upholds all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look expectantly to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand to satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways, gracious in all his works, and the Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. And then, of course, the verse I mentioned last week as well in James 1:17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Well, you know, Jesus taught that God is good. We read that in the psalm, and Jesus even mentions that God provides for the animals everything they need, especially the food and nourishment they need to get along. God provides for the world, whether they believe in him or not. He gives us the air to breathe, all of the beauty of this world, this earth, and the universe. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the expanse shows his handiwork. Everybody can see that, and there are some beautiful, beautiful places on this earth, and a lot of good things, and they're gifts of God. Now, I want to change direction just a little bit and pose the question. Have you ever been in a bad situation? I mean, things don't look good at all, and you pray, and you pray, and you pray, and guess what? Things go from bad to worse. I've been there and done that, and I know you have to. And you know, we begin to question God. Well, is he listening? Does he really care? Is he there at all? We just wonder, why doesn't God answer my prayer? At least the way we want him to. I want to read another quote from Lawson. I read a quote last week, but this is something he mentioned about the goodness of God. He says, it's not uncommon for those who face pain and hardship in this life to doubt the goodness of God. There you go. I think everybody knows, we all recognize we doubt God's goodness. But he says the clear message of Scripture is that God is uniquely good, and he is the measure of everything good. And so when we consider together with his wisdom and power, his attributes, Christians can be assured that God not only desires to reveal his goodness, but is able to accomplish his good plan in the best possible way. But I want to add to that one of my favorite authors and a quote that I mentioned last week. Oh, I love this. It speaks to my heart. We are not necessarily, C.S. Lewis said, we're not necessarily doubting that God will do the best for us, but we're wondering how painful the best will turn out to be. We don't doubt that God is good, but how much is it going to cost us? How painful will the best, his goodness, turn out to be? Well, the fact is, you know, it's true, believers do not escape wars, plagues, earthquakes, illnesses, trials and tribulations, viruses, and ultimately death. We're all destined to die. And after that, the judgment, the Bible says. Now, the good news is the goodness of God. God is planning for eternity. So I wanted to close with this in 1 Thessalonians. Paul the Apostle writes, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Yes, God is good, ultimately, he's the best of all the goodness. And we thank him for that. So let's bow in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for your goodness towards us. We're thankful for this time together. This is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And we confess that we often doubt your goodness, especially as we endure the virus that plagues our nation and our world, the current crises. But there's always crises. And we just pray for our president and Congress and all others in places of authority that they humble themselves and seek your will in this time of trouble. And we know that we're not worthy of the least of your mercies, yet you have shown your mercy toward the suffering through the suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus the Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Hello, and welcome to our Missions Moments. Today we're going to look at three missionary stories, again from our book, Voices of the Faithful. And we'll be looking at stories in light of the first line of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our first story is from Helen, who serves the Lord in Middle America and the Caribbean. The title of her story is Never Alone, and the scripture is John 14, 16, and 18. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Helen writes, it began as an evangelism explosion project in Quetzaltenango, a city in western Guatemala. A family accepted the Lord and opened their home for a neighborhood Bible study. Slowly, the group grew. Land was found for a church building, and the little congregation decided to do much of the work themselves to lower the costs. Since many people have vacation days the week before Easter, they decided that those days could be dedicated to digging the foundation. The first workday was scheduled for 9 a.m. on a Saturday. My husband and children had prior obligations. By the time I dropped them off and got some cookies and juice, it was nearly 10 a.m. I drove up to the work site and climbed out with my hoe and shovel. At first, it seemed no one was there. Then, over to the side, I saw the pastor working alone. He must be discouraged, I thought, as I poured him a cup of juice and walked over. Hello, Brother Kelso. Are you out here working all alone? Oh no, he laughed. The Lord is here with me. Well, now there are three of us, I said. Let's get to work. Before the day was over, others had joined us, and a good start had been made. Now, when I feel like I am all alone in some project or ministry, I remember Brother Kelso and say, oh no, I am not alone. The Lord is here with me. You may have felt alone during the COVID-19 restrictions. What a wonderful reminder that our Heavenly Father has sent us His Holy Spirit, the Counselor, the Advocate, the Comforter, to be with us forever. In Isaiah 57:15, we read, "For this is what the High and Exalted One says, He who lives forever, whose name is holy. I live in a high and holy place, but also with the one who is contrite and lowly in spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." Our second story today is from Gina, who serves in Central Asia. The title of her story is Under His Wings, and the scripture reference is Psalm 91, verse 4. He will shield you with His wings. He will shelter you with His feathers. His faithful promises are your armor and protection. Gina writes, "Being fearful for the lives of loved ones caught me prepared this time. It was November 20th in Central Asia. At 11:05 a.m., our lives and the country in which we lived would change. Kaboom! The sound rang through the city, shaking the house and ground. I waited. 10 minutes later, another kaboom. I paused again. What could be so loud? Then silence. Panic rose up in me. 5 days earlier, two Jewish synagogues had been bombed. Turning on the television, I looked with horror at torn apart buildings, destruction, and death in our city. My mind turned to my children at school and my husband returning from our town. Were they safe? One of the two bombings had occurred only 1 mile from our house. My response normally in situations like this would be fear, helplessness, and despair. But the Lord had prepared me for this moment and gave me peace. This was not the first time I had reason to fear for my family and friends. Anti-American protests about the war in Iraq and bomb threats at our church had brought anxiety. During those times, I had memorized Psalm 91. Meditating on His Word would sustain me during this trial, too. I continued to recite this chapter out loud. Calm settled over me instead of fear. My husband safely arrived home later, and our children returned home early from school. The city we lived in mourned the fallen. God's word gives comfort, peace, and hope. Life can be uncertain, but He always remains our refuge. In 2012, I had the privilege of going to Israel. Our tour guide was Naomi, a lovely Jewish Christian. Her father, also a Jewish Christian, was a tour guide as well. One day we were walking single file through the old city of Jerusalem with Naomi in the lead. Each of us wore a headset so that we could hear her commentary. All of a sudden, we heard her excitedly exclaim, "Abba!" Because coming toward us was her daddy, leading his own tour group. The term has been more vivid to me ever since. In time of great suffering, Jesus cried out to His Abba, Daddy. And as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we too can cry out to our Abba, Daddy, confident that He hears us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Our last story is from Julie, who serves in Central and Eastern Europe. The title of her story is "He," meaning God, "Gets the Glory." The scripture verse is Exodus 20, 24b. "Wherever I cause my name to be honored, I will come and bless you." Julie writes, "We have so many plans for ministering among our people group. Often, however, plans fail, never happen, or are altered in ways that make our original thoughts completely unrecognizable. We spent a lot of time, money, energy, and prayers in one village. It began to look like a black hole with no results. Then, one Sunday, a man from the village told the church he had had a dream in which a man told him to read the Bible. He read through the Gospels in a couple of weeks, seeking the truth. God has been teaching me that we can plan and strategize, but He causes His name to be honored. How great is that, We aren't responsible for people coming to Christ. When we see God causing his name to be honored, as with this man being drawn to him solely through the Holy Spirit, we feel his presence and are blessed to witness his glory. I found a verse that addresses how to build an altar and worship the Lord. God emphasizes that there are to be no dressed stones or steps leading up to the altar. God wants the complete focus of our worship, not the work of our hands. God causes his name to be honored, not us. And if we try to take the credit for his work, our weaknesses and faults will be exposed. When we see God moving, we are brought to our knees in worship. We are encouraged that our witnessing is not in vain. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Hallowed, honored as holy, set apart, pure. My mother tried, unsuccessfully, to get me to memorize the shorter catechism when I was a little girl. The only questions and answer that I can remember are the first one. You may know it too. What is the chief end of man? The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. One definition of glorify is to light up brilliantly. In teaching children, I like to illustrate this with a flashlight. When we praise God for who he is and thank him for what he does, it's as though we're shining the flashlight on him. We glorify him. Indeed, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
For all of the Vespers team, I thank you for watching today. We'll close with prayer and the benediction. O Lord, our Lord, how magnificent is your name in all the earth. We do believe that you are good to us and for us. But I pray, help us in our unbelief when things don't go the way we want them to. We thank you that things always go your way. And so we pray for patience as our nation endures the coronavirus. Bless our families and other loved ones during this time of separation and uncertainty. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us all till we meet again. In his name, amen.
God's sustaining grace. surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Let us run the race, not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us. Let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly lives. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. After all our hopes and dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them to the road we each must find.
Thank you for being with us for virtual Vespers. Please take a moment now to look at our link below. Without cost, tapping this link will give you weekly notice and quick access to our programming.